Yeah, so I'm in the Department of Chemistry, and I'm an assistant college lecturer. So today we're going to talk about how to design your own digital escape room and what's kind of some challenges and things to think about as you're designing these, but really the possibilities are endless. There's so many things that you can do as you build these. So the example I'm going to be using today, I actually designed, my daughter just finished first grade. So I used a first grade learning objective, which is counting to 10. And I'm going to put this example, let me get the chat out of here, in the chat so you guys can kind of see one of the ones that I created kind of off the bat. I'm going to walk you through a little bit of this, and we'll actually spend some time today building your own escape room and some of the activities there. So let me... So what it should look like, so as you pull this up, what you're going to notice is that at the very top is a header, and we have our goal. So our learning objective here is to identify the missing addend to 10. So we're adding to 10. So which two numbers do we need to make 10? Then right below that is kind of our catch. So what's the goal? What's the problem that the students are trying to solve? So in this case, the theme that I chose here was African Serengeti. I let my daughter choose the theme for this, and she was really into African animals at the time. So then the way that this is built is that we, if you scroll down a little bit further, there is an image, and all of these images are kind of layered on top, and there's links, hyperlinks hidden in this image. So you can kind of scroll around. Anytime that your cursor changes from an arrow to a finger, that means that there's a link hidden there. So as we kind of move around here, you'll notice that one of them takes you to a Google slide, and it has some problems here. So you have to figure out which number goes in there. So right now this is in my actual account, but so you would say, okay, 2 + 8 = 10. And so then you would use the cipher down here on the left to figure out that the 2 would correspond to an I. And so that would be part of your clue. And then you would do the next one, 8 + 2 = 10, and find the 8. And that would give you the letter for your clue. There is also a Kahoot in there. The students really like the Kahoots, although Kahoots changed a lot of their settings this year. So it's more challenging to do this free. It used to be completely free. But they've changed it. So, but you can join the game. So we might do this synchronously, or they can do this on their own. So if I enter and join in this game here, I don't think this link works for you guys. But then it's going to pop up with questions, and this is actually competitive. So here's a question, 1 + 7 = 10. And then the students can then select which one it is and earn points, and it'll give you like a leaderboard as you're going through. I usually you have to hide a clue in each one of these activities. So in the Kahoot, it might just be a question at the end. And so here, 4 + what = 10, and then you can select the answer. Kahoot's fantastic in the classroom as a review, or they can do it asynchronously as well. This Kahoot, or this particular escape room, also has a matching game. So here you'd have to match. So 3 + what = 10. And so you can kind of go through, you can do images, which is fantastic for science. If it supports images or just text, it's kind of up to you. And so we can match. So 1 + 9 = 10, and those will stay listed. And then for this particular matching game, their escape room clue will pop up when they have it all correct. You can also do, this is one that I actually used for a pharmacology course that I teach with undergraduate and graduate students. And so you can actually do kind of like fake news. So this one was imitating a text stream between two people. And so their clues are kind of mixed in here. You can also do Facebook or newspaper articles, all of those. You can create them to every single detail. So I got to choose everything, how full the battery was, the names, the what went where, how many speech bubbles there were, who the carrier was. So you can choose all of those. It's really kind of an incredible thing to use there. EduCandy, I use this a lot. It's fantastic for vocab. And you put in a set of terms and definitions, and then the students can choose how they interact. So my favorite is the matchup, but you can use any of them. So for the matchup, it'll all show up all at the same time. And then you just kind of drag and drop as it, so they can play. And the great thing is too, they get to choose the activity. It's the same set of data, but they get to choose. And so you just drag and drop them up here and it gives them immediate feedback. So for here, you know, you just drag them up. And I make the escape room clue pretty obvious where it just doesn't fit with anything else. And so here our escape room clue is going to be zebra. And if you do it wrong, so 4 plus 5, it gives them feedback here. So that was pretty nice. We will get to that one later. And then at the very bottom of this site is where the students are going to put in their answers. So they'll put in their names. So you can actually take this and keep it as a grade or track the students if you would like to. And just depends on how you have your Google form set up. And then the students would actually just type in their clue right here. And I have it so it'll give them feedback. So if it's wrong, like this first one, if I typed in lion, it would say, make sure it's in all caps. So you can choose what type of feedback you're providing your students for each one of these. So let's go back. So that's kind of what we're working towards for that. So this is something that I have used for my undergraduate students, my graduate students as well. There are a lot of ways you can use these activities. My preference is to use it as a review. So as preparation for a summative assessment, but you can do this to introduce new content. You can do this for in-class group work. So maybe you just want to have them do a particular activity and so you can design this for a particular unit. So we're going to kind of go through some of the steps to come up with this final product for your students. So of course, the very first thing to do is identify what's the purpose of this activity? What are you trying to get across? And so in this particular case, it might be it's a summative or it's a preparation for a summative assessment. So you're trying to give the students an opportunity to gauge their learning and identify where they might need some remediation. Or maybe your purpose is to introduce new content. So they're going to be exploring a particular idea. I'm writing the prompt. So that is like your catcher. What's the problem that they're trying to solve? Why are they in this escape room per se? And then create those activities. So I showed you some of the activities that are available, but really the possibilities are endless. If you're using a Google slide, you can create anything that you would like, really. And then kind of putting it together. So I used all Google free things to do this. So it didn't cost any money. They're all completely free and free of use, open source activities here. Some of them require an account, but only I needed an account. So the students could actually interact with everything without creating any accounts, which is really awesome. And they were all free for me, so I didn't spend any money with this either. But you will need a Google account. So if you don't yet have one, they are free. I know at Cleveland State, we're a Microsoft school. So a lot of this isn't, you would need your own personal Google account, which kind of stinks. But you can do a lot of it with Microsoft. It's just that I came from a Google school, so it's just something that I'm a little bit more comfortable with. So if you needed a Google account, this is the link to actually set one up. And again, completely free. So you get an email address and such. I know I like that the Microsoft Office is good, but some of the other things are, I miss Google. Now, just a tip, if you're creating this, there are going to be a lot of files. So when I'm doing and creating a new one, I have a dedicated folder where I dump everything for the escape room into one spot. And that way you can find it and easily access everything that you need. And I'm going to share a template for you guys at the end today so that you'll have like one spot where you can just put in all of your escape room clues and your links, because it can be kind of a lot to keep track of. So learning objective is always the first step, and then kind of identifying a theme. So sometimes if you can do this up front, sometimes you might want to do your activities and then kind of tie it into a theme later on. So the one we're working with today is African Serengeti. And I must say, I am not really great with puns. I usually go ask my husband and be like, hey, this is the theme. Can you come up with something kind of funny? And then he tends to write my prompts. He's very handy with this. But you can make them as serious or as ridiculous as you would like. And then you always want to, in the back of my head, it's like, all right, how am I going to incorporate a clue that they can use to put in a Google form at the end of the activity? So some of the activities are really easy to do that. Some of them you kind of have to think a little bit. So activity ideas, what you saw. So I showed you Kahoot and a Google slide where I just had questions on there. The Google slide's really great because you can actually have, I'll put like an image and I'll black out images from like a textbook or a process. And then the students can drag and drop ideas or pictures right onto there. So there's a lot of options for that. Jigsaw puzzle is really awesome. So you can create an image and then they have to like drag and drop the pictures to put the picture back together. Or the sorting activity, the fake news generator is kind of like the text stream that I showed you. And then matching. And these are just some of them that I kind of tend to default to, depending on what type of content you want the students to do. And again, you can make your clues as straightforward or as convoluted as you would like. There's even like, you can get online generators as well. I tend to try and keep the clues a little bit more straightforward so that my students are focusing on the content, but you can make these super crazy also. So like here you could have the number. So I might have a quantitative question and they'd have to match it to the letter. And the letter is a word. They don't have to be words, but whatever you would like really. So right now we're gonna go ahead and get started and create a Google slide. So hopefully you have a Google account. If not, you can kind of watch as I go through this, but you're gonna go to slides.google.com. Let me put that link in there. And we're gonna create one. So your goal is to create 4 questions and you can use the add-ins to 10 because that's super easy. So like 2 numbers equaling to 10. And then try and incorporate some sort of cipher or how are you going to do your clue? So 4 questions, you can use the clue lion or come up with your own. So I'm going to. So when you're in Google Slides, so these are some of the Google Slides. You can see some of the other activities that I've created. And I'm going to choose a blank Google slide here. And you can select and put in your text boxes however you would like. And we're going to create 4 questions. So 7. And then kind of think about how are you going to incorporate your clue into these questions? Oops, oh, where'd it go? There goes. One of the other nice things about Google is that it automatically saves it, even if you haven't given it a title. But you just change the file name up at the top. It automatically saves it right into your Google Drive. So then from here, I came up with 4 questions. I like to kind of put my answer key off to the side so I don't forget. So it'd be 8, 3, 5, and 7. And then we have to put in our cipher. So if we're going to create some sort of table here, you can insert and we'll do like a table. This way we can, we'll put an extra one in so that it's not super obvious. And if our clue is gonna be lion, let's go back and assign these. And then you can kind of put any sort of random numbers down over here. Make sure that you incorporate each of the ones you need for your cipher. 8, 3, 5, and let's put a 2. And then you can put your, whatever they're assigned to. So 5 needs to be O, 8 needs to be L. Oops, yeah, 2 is, oh, we don't have one. So we can put P or whatever letter you want and N. And you would wanna make sure that you put, we're gonna delete our answer key. And then you have your cipher. So you have your questions and you have your cipher. You probably want to put some directions up at the top so students know what to do. And you can always make this a lot fancier also. So this would just be a really straightforward activity for the students to do, depending on what each of them Now, the next part here is going to be to actually create your room. So when I'm creating a room, I use drawings.google. So what this is, it's really similar to Google Slides, but it is specific for making drawings and layering things on. Now, what we're actually going to do is do an image search, a Google image search, and we can type in, let's type in African Serengeti. And if you go over to images, this is going to give you all sorts of images that are related. Now, the problem with this is that the ultimate website that you're creating is going to be open. Technically, anyone could view this. So you want to make sure that you're using open a Creative Commons licensing. So to do that, you're going to want to go, sometimes I have struggle here. To find where that is, not here. Where is it? Did they change this? Oh, goodness. Oh, here we go. So under tools, you want to go to Creative Commons licenses. So in your Google search, you go to tools, click Creative Commons licenses. This is going to only give you material that has a Creative Commons license. You can also do commercial and such as well. And that way, you know, whatever you're looking at is pretty likely to be creative use so that you'll be able to use it in your website. So you can save the image and put this actually in a folder on your desktop or wherever you would like it to be so that all of your images for your particular escape room are all in one spot. Right now, I'm just going to copy it. And we're going to put this over in our drawing that we're building. Now sometimes this one is really pixelated, so sometimes it's better to save it, or you might need to get a different image so that it saves it a little bit better. One of the nice things about Google Drawings is that you can adjust the size of your board, so you can change it and lock it into whatever size that you actually need. So I have a little bit of space here, so we're going to go ahead and tighten this up a little bit as we go through. Now we kind of have our scene set, and we can go back over to our Google search and maybe want some elephants or lions or something in your scene. You can start layering objects on top of this. So if we type in lion, now I typically recommend, I try to use more cartoons because they're easier to layer. They're less likely to have a background on them. So if we were to use something like this, and let's say I copied it and I put it over on my image, notice that the background doesn't match. So there is a way around that. And what we can do, I'm going to take you to a website that's actually going to remove the background, which makes it so much easier to layer different images on there. But what I found is that the cartoons actually are much easier because they're less likely to have a busy background. So they're easier to remove these. And you can use whatever kind of images that you like or your own pictures. And again, you always need to double check that you're looking for Creative Commons licensing each time. So here I'm going to save this image. And I'm just going to put it somewhere on my computer. I'm just going to toss it on my desktop for now. Now, if we go to that website that I showed you, so remove background, what you're going to do is just drag and drop your image. And it's automatically going to take the background away from that image. Now, it doesn't always do a great job, so you can edit it and make adjustments like you need to. This one actually looks really good. Sometimes you have to check the eyeballs a little bit. And here we can see it missed a little bit over here. So if we wanted to kind of fix this so we could erase, I can make my brush a little bit smaller and really kind of clean up the image a little bit. Some of them are better than others. It doesn't, and again, this is completely free. So we can go ahead and download that image. And again, putting it into that same folder that you've been working with. And then we can drag that back up into our image. And notice that the edges are a lot cleaner here. My guess is this one, that line might be okay. But it just kind of takes some practice to identify what images where are the backgrounds super easy to get around and which ones are a little bit trickier. Let's go ahead and try this one out and see how this one looks. Yeah, this one actually worked pretty well. And then you can just download it to your computer and then you just drag and drop the new image on here. So it's a lot cleaner. And this one actually looks like it belongs with this image rather than one with the messy background on it. Now we already made one of our activities. So this would be our add-ins to 10. Now, one thing you need to do is make sure that it's shareable. So right now the Google Slides that I created was private and it was only available to me. So you always want to make sure that you share it and then change to anyone with the link. That way you're going to know that your students are actually going to be able to see it. So you're going to copy that link and we can actually put this right into our drawing. So let's use our realistic one. And Control K, I'll type that in there. Control K, or if you're on a Mac, it's Command K. That is the keyboard shortcut to add in a hyperlink. And then you can just put your link for your activities right there and apply it. And if it's a Google thing, it's really nice because it gives you a preview right there in your Google drawing on what the file looks like and what's going on there. So then we can have all sorts of images. You'll notice the escape room that I initially designed, I had like 10 images all layered on top of each other with different activities hyperlinked in. So once you have this kind of assembled, you're going to want to try and get your Google Forms. So forms.google.com is a great way and a great outlet for your students to input what they're doing. And so I'm gonna pull one up here. So you can put in, okay, so what are the names of the people? And then you can have different sections. This was a bad one. That was a kind of a standalone activity. Here is an actual escape room that I designed. So for the final exam, we kind of had a summer theme for it. And then here were each of the locks. And so the students would actually put in each one of their clues. So I just put in the Kahoot clue. And I can actually show you. So if you create a Google form, what you're going to want to do here is go up to add a question. And you want it to be a short answer. So in your short answer question, you can put in Google Slides and you can put in what the answer is. So in this particular case, our text, let's make it required. And we're going to click response validation. So we're going to have, and then right underneath of it, you have all these options. So you want to go to if you have a number or if you have text. So in this case, we have text and we want it to contain the word lion. And we can put all caps or whatever kind of feedback you want the students to receive if the answer is incorrect. And you can make it required, meaning that they have to have a response there in order for them to submit their particular Google form. So again, these are some of the other ones that I did. I really do like the validation option. This is also great if you want the Google form to grade it automatically for you. If you want, you can also make it a quiz. So if you go up to settings, which is the little gearbox in the top right, you can make it a quiz and you can assign point values and then have it actually come out as a grade. And you'd be able to see in a Google Sheet, all of the students' scores and such. If you do that, make sure that you are requiring them to put their full name or student ID or email address. Make sure that that's required. So you can also do collect emails. And that way you know that you can tie it directly to a particular student. Now, what I like to do at the very end is to have some sort of congratulations after they have completed their escape room. So here would be congratulations, you solved the puzzles. And then I might put in a fun image. So sometimes I might put a Bitmoji of myself in there. Or something fun. So this one, again, beach theme. So there I am on the beach. I'm gonna go ahead and delete this because this was a live thing that I had. So once you have your Google form, now we're actually ready to put our whole site together. So before we move on to this, the remove background is really awesome. Questions before we move on to how to build and put our site together? And we'll have time for more questions kind of at the end here. So sites.google, this allows you to create your very own website. And the reason that I'm using sites.google is because it's really seamless with all of the Google apps. So I'm going to be able to drag and drop my Google drawing. I'm going to be able to drag and drop my Google forms and have everything in one spot and talking to each other really seamlessly. So we're going to go up and we're going to hit blank. This is just going to give us a completely blank slate. So you can create a title for your site. So this might be add-ins to 10. And we can put, this is going to be your actual website name. So it's going to have a little tag at the end, and that's going to be your website name. You have a lot of control over this, what type of header, if it's going to be title only, large banner, whatever you would like. You can also adjust all your text as well. I think it's a little too big. I usually make it a little smaller. The great news is you can also change your image either to one that you have, or you can actually select an image from Google. And so you might just do a search, African Serengeti. And so then you can choose. So this is the same image that we were using before. One word of caution, because this is a banner, you kind of want, there's not a lot of play in this image. So it's best if the image, most of the bulk of the image is kind of in the middle. And I'll show you what I mean here. So if we did, let's say we chose this one, a lot of it's going to be cut off, which may not necessarily be what you're looking for. Oops, that's not what I wanted. So you may want to change to a particular image that you know it's going to look decent with the top and bottom kind of cut off. I think this one tended to work well. And I haven't quite figured out, or they just don't give you a lot of options to like drag and drop or alter it. I'm assuming that that's probably coming. It's just not there yet. Now you can also adjust this for readability. So it'll automatically make sure that the text and the background image is a decent enough contrast. On the right side of the page, you'll notice that there are all of your tools. So you can insert text, you can insert images, and insert things from your Google Drive. So this is where I might put my prompt for my escape room. So whatever text, and what's the problem? What are the students trying to solve? Or what's the goal of this particular activity? And then below that, you can insert your Google drawing that you are putting together. So if you click on Drive, it's going to access all of the files on your Google Drive. And if you go to Recent, it's going to show you everything that you just worked on, which is pretty awesome. So here is the, I didn't title it, but my untitled drawing that we just put together. And you go ahead and insert that right into your website. And if you use these little squares or the little dots on the corner, you can resize it however you would like. So if you want it super big or not so big, and you can resize it here. And then the last part would be to put, so this is going to have all your links and activities linked into it. Then the last part is going to be to put in your Google form. So if we go again to Recent, we should have our Google form in here. And we can insert that. And again, you can make this as big or small as you would like. So then from here, you always want to, I mean, it's always good to kind of double check some things. This one looks pretty decent, and we can publish this. And what you're going to notice is that who can view my site? I typically say, request public search engines do not display. So I say anyone can do it because you're going to have I have a lot of students. So you just want to make sure that it's not publicly available, especially if you might have images or something. You have to make sure everything is Creative Commons licensing. And so just requesting that the public search engines don't display it can be helpful. And then you just click publish and your website is good to go. And you can see there's the website name, and I share that with my students. And then they can go through and complete this as many times as they would like and interact with it however they want to. Yeah, absolutely. So this type of process or this type of activity is so open. There are so many options and such as you're going through this. I'm going to show you a different one that I created here that was, it's a lot more straightforward, and you can actually keep it, oops, not that one. You actually can just keep it completely within Google Forms if you wanted to use Forms in Office. So this is one that I used for one of my pharmacology classes. So this is an upper level majors class in chemistry. And so I might drop them a video. So I drop them a YouTube video to watch and then some follow-up questions with that. And then the next one was, hey, here's a Prezi to interact with that had content. So I was introducing a new unit here. And then here's some follow-up questions for that. And then here is some text to read. And then questions. And then here was a matching activity for them to do. And then here is a primary research article that has to do with this content. And so then they could interact with that and then answer those questions. And then here are just some kind of multiple choice wrapping up types of questions also. So that type of activity where it's just in Google Forms, or if you were using Microsoft Office Forms, is a lot more streamlined, because then you're just using one thing rather than creating your site and your drawings and all of that. And my students seem to like this type of activity also. I call these station labs. If we were doing it in person, I could have each activity on a different table. And this was my reaction to going all online this year, was to put it in Google Forms. Yeah, it is. And the students can't, it keeps them, it gives them different things to do, and they can do typically in my classroom, if they were out on a table, each activity, they could do it in any order. And so it gives them freedom to move around the classroom and do this. And you can still keep that, or keep like the Google form, and then also have them move around the classroom doing activities at each particular table. And then only have all the questions on a piece of paper, and then have them submit their answers electronically, or have them submit them on paper form also. But I wanted to give you kind of this so that you could, here I can give you the link to this. So you can kind of see what it would look like kind of pared down also, because there are so many options with this type of thing. And something else I wanted to give you guys, and we'll go through this hopefully. So I'm giving you guys a Word document right now. This Word document is something that I put together that walks you through it, because it was a lot of information today, and I know that. But what it does is it walks you through what is going on for this. And so this is the file that I just put in there. And it kind of walks you through each one of the steps. And especially when you're creating activities, so I'm giving you the links to each one of these activities and some of the tips, like make sure you do adjust this share settings. This is huge. And I can't tell you the number of times that I did not do this. And then I'm like, and then you have to do it because the students are emailing you, I can't access this. So trying to give you some of the tips and things. If it requires an account, so like the Jigsaw Planet is super fun, but you do have to create an account. But again, it's totally free. Now, one of the great things about this document, I'm going to scroll all the way down to the bottom. I gave you a template. So this is one place where you can dump all of your information for your escape room and keep it without having to go like a million places. So like, what's the name of your activity? You could put in the link for your particular activity right here. So everything's going to be hyperlinked. And then what's your clue? Because you need to make sure that the right clue is going to the right activity as you're putting everything together. So that can be really helpful. And then sometimes it's helpful to be like, all right, what types of images, what types of animals or whatever are you actually looking for? So I might just kind of start brainstorming things that I would be looking for in Google, and then building your Google form. And then what's your final website, the actual hyperlink for that, so that you can then share that with students. If you're interested in the Bitmoji, I do have the directions on how to create a Bitmoji in here. So that would be in step five. So what page are we on here? Page 8. So if you're interested in kind of getting your, no, that's not it here, this one, page 7. Again, totally optional, just kind of something fun and weird to do if you wanted a Bitmoji with your kind of likeness on it in computer form, I suppose. So those directions in that file also for that. So again, the example that I created today, my daughter's in first grade. You can kind of see her little curls sticking out. She loved it. So she was like, can we do it again? Like she wanted to keep playing it, but then also all the way up to my graduate students. And so depending on your audience and the types of questions and activities that you have, you can really hit a wide audience here as well. So Tysa, yeah, especially for like physics, because you can put in questions and like problem sets or scenarios with this also. But questions or other things you guys want to see or go over in our last couple minutes here?
This is awesome, Erin. I have a question. So my students, I always pull them to think about where I keep my LMS, like if I'm going to use Blackboard or Teams. And I'm wondering, mm-hmm. if you're using so many Google tools, do you keep them all in Google or do you integrate them to Blackboard or do you use Teams for your primary remote learning platform for remote learning or what? What your strategy is? I know what mine is, but I'm interested to hear yours.
Yeah, so I use Blackboard and I kept everything in one spot. We use Blackboard for everything. So for this, the great thing is the students don't need much. You give them that first link and then everything is hyperlinked within it. So they don't need anything else. They don't need accounts. Everything is free, it's open. And except for the Kahoot's a little strange now, but for my students, I actually assigned the Kahoot. And so then it's a little bit different than the one I use today. And so they don't need any accounts and all they're doing is clicking. And so it's super easy for them. So it doesn't even matter if you're using Teams or whatever, because all you're doing is sending out that initial hyperlink and they're good to go.
Nice. Thank you. Mm-hmm. My daughter just did your classroom and she's in first grade next year and she loved it.
Yep. Yeah. She was, my daughter was like, can we do it again? I was like, I just did it. It's okay.
Good to have a tester.
That is important. Oh my gosh. Always go through your final website and check all your links before you launch it to your students. Always do that. But it's tricky because Google automatically logs you in. So I actually like would text it to my phone or send it to a different device that wasn't logged in to try and double check, because unfortunately Google just has you automatically logged in. So you'll always be able to view it, which really mm-hmm. kind of stinks. So you have to send it to a different device and to check all your hyperlinks.
Could you use a different router?
Oh, maybe. Oh, mm-hmm. possibly.
Or I do incognito windows in Chrome because it doesn't keep you signed in.
Mm-hmm. Yeah, that's a great idea. Yeah, just running through and making sure that all your, because the Google stuff, you have to change your share settings. And mm-hmm. just make sure things are working out okay.
Yeah.
Erin, I really like the escape room concept. It reminded me a lot of a conversation that I had with another educator who utilized QR codes into the room. And yeah. So in the same way that you have kind of this interface where all the links are integrated into an image almost, mm-hmm. it's the same kind of a way where he actually had a bunch of QR codes put up onto his board in the front of the room. And if he had any remediation that needed to be done for those students, they could take out their phone, pull up the same kind of QR mm-hmm. code that is connected to a link that will then take them to an activity in the same way that the escape room does. And I really think that's super cool. And it's kind of a different way of integrating technology, but the mm-hmm. same ultimate goal is super cool.
Yeah, absolutely. And the great thing too is it would be really easy to differentiate this kind of activity as well. Be like, all right, well, yes, we're going to keep, everyone's going to do the EduCandy matching, but instead of this activity, I'm going to swap out this link. And then you could differentially send out the final escape room to specific sets of students also to kind of target, your high, mid, lows, or depending on IEPs that might need different accommodations, you can easily tackle that also. And a lot of the work is kind of like the bones I would spend, the exhausting part was like, all right, putting together the image and like, what's my theme and all of that. But I actually reused them. So I taught 7 different classes last year, and I would use the same escape room bones and theme, and then just swap out the hyperlinks, which made it actually a lot easier. Be like, so my beach theme, everyone had the beach theme for their final exam escape room. I just swapped out the activities for the content for my different classes. Yeah. And you can keep using it. And all it is a hyperlink. There's a couple things like the Kahoot you have to update each time, but otherwise you can just keep reusing it, which is amazing. And again, if you want it for grades, I used it formatively, so it wasn't required because it was usually just in preparation for exams, but you can easily do those Google Forms to collect scores and assign grades. And then if you're a Google school, it'll automatically integrate into you can get it integrated with your grade book. For us, you'd have to do it manually, but whatever your choice is.
Awesome. Do we have any other questions for Erin? Need to scroll to see you all. Hold on. it looks good. That was great. And like I said in the chat, I'm already in my brain thinking about how we could do this with like a SharePoint site and the same kind of thing, even though it would only be for CSU students or, you know, institutionally based, it could also work. So I'm excited to try it. Thank you. Let's give Erin a Zoom clap. Awesome. Thank you all, especially the 3 of you who presented this afternoon, Monica, Erin, and Mandy, for coming and for giving your tutorials and workshops and for letting us record you for our referatory. We're really excited to share the content, and because it's summer and everybody's all over the place, I think it'll be really good content to have in our collaborative for people to view. So I really appreciate it. And also something to think about, we've collected all the links. Will and Kalita have been behind the scenes collecting all the links you've shared to put in the referatory. But also we're piloting showcases in our referatory, which are curated content. And so something like building the escape room or, you know, integrating, you know, knowledge about dialects and linguistic diversity right into your classroom, those things could also be useful to have if you find that any of our venues help you and you want to get published or anything like that. We also have the case studies, which some of you have already written, where you can share. So feel free to keep in touch with us. We hope that you'll be here for for other sessions in the sandbox. This week we have 4 more presentations tomorrow. We'll be in the Gather Town during lunchtime for anyone who wants to come by and kind of sit with us during lunchtime. And next week we'll have drop-in spaces for assignment building and, you know, being kind of in community while we're building an escape room or doing something, you know, that you've learned about this week. So feel free to drop by, and I hope to see you all again in the next couple of weeks. And if not, definitely at other collaborative events. So thanks so much.